This is the Pulse of St. Louis.
Welcome to the Pulse of St. Louis. I'm Shirley Washington. In the 1950s, the city of Creve Coeur condemned the home of a prominent African-American doctor to prevent him and his family from moving into the community. Well, the land his home was built on was turned into Beirne Park, and his home was turned into the park's country club. Now there's an effort to right the wrong that happened to Dr. Howard Venable and his wife, Katie, decades ago. I spoke with Jim Singer, a historian, to learn more details about this story.
I'm from St. Louis, and in the early to mid-1960s, my parents took our family to Beirne Park. And my mother told me the story of the park, that a prominent African-American physician had bought a home in Creve Coeur, and the city took his home and turned it into this park. So fast forward 50 years, hard to believe, 2 years ago, I was taking my own grandson, who was 4 years old then, to Beirne Park. My son, daughter-in-law, and three grandsons all live in Creve Coeur. And I look around and I think to myself, this is the park my mother told me about. Nothing to tell the story of the park. And I went on the website, nothing. And that really motivated me to want to research and write about the story of the park. I've always been interested in history, and at this stage of my life, I thought, well, wouldn't this be a great piece to write about and see if I could get some public interest on it.
So why did the city of Creve Coeur take the family's property?
Well, I hate to, you know, the R word is not in people don't like to hear that, but I think
racism,
it was racism. What happened in a nutshell was that the Venables, Dr. Howard, Katie Venable, and 11 other African-American families sought to move into what then was called Spady Meadows, which was just getting platted. It really was a story, to some extent, right out of the movie Raisin in the Sun. The families were approached by an attorney who represented their white neighbors and who, I think, basically said, you're not welcomed here, and made an offer to buy them out. So 11 of the 12 families sold out. The one family who didn't sell out was Dr. Howard and Katie Venable. Dr. Venable was, believed in fighting for his civil rights. He thought he had the same right to live there as anyone else. So what happened next was that the what's really kind of unusual about the situation is that the role of the city. So the this all happened very quickly. The city set up a citizens committee on parks. The citizens committee had one meeting. They made two recommendations to the city. One is that if the neighbors in any subdivision wanted to have a park in the subdivision, and if the neighbors paid a portion of the land acquisition, then the city had to do what the neighbors wanted. And the second part was to have the park at the Venables' home. So that recommendation goes to the city. It becomes an ordinance, and the Venables are told, you either sell your property to the city or we're going to bring a condemnation action. And there was then a three-year lawsuit from 1956, 1959, where the city tried to take the property, and the Venables said this was race discrimination. One of the interesting things about this story is that the neighbors raised $25,000 in 1956 to give to the city to finance this park purchase. That is really an astounding amount of money. It's about $250,000 in today's dollars. And when you think about the fear and the racism that motivated those neighbors to come up with that kind of money, it really is astounding.
And what's even more astounding is they're trying to keep a family out.
Now, Dr. Howard Venable was just an outstanding St. Louisan and American. He was the first African-American on the faculty of Washington University School of Medicine. His portrait hangs in the School of Medicine. He received a national humanitarian award from the American Ophthalmology Society, and just all sorts of awards, just an outstanding individual.
So what actually happened with the property? I mean, I understand that it became a park. So did the Venables just give up, or what happened?
Well, what happened then at the end of 1959, the case is finally decided by the Missouri Court of Appeals, and this is one of the tragedies of the case, that the Missouri Court of Appeals said that the city, now this is 1959, that the city had the right to take his home and exclude him because of his race. Pretty astounding today, but that's what the court said. They could not prevent the city from doing this. So Dr. Venable finally at that point gave in and sold his property to the city. Now, one of the other interesting parts of this story is that while Dr. Venable was fighting this battle with the city, Temple Israel, which was a Jewish synagogue that was then located in the city, had bought property in Creve Coeur as well. And Creve Coeur had prevented Temple Israel from building its synagogue. So there were two lawsuits going on in tandem with each other. There was the Venable race discrimination lawsuit, the Temple Israel religious discrimination. Within 6 months of the Venable decision, the Missouri Court of Appeals actually ruled in favor of Temple Israel, so they were able to build that large synagogue that's there at Ladue and Warson. While Dr. Venable was fighting this battle, he did make common cause with Temple Israel. It was heavily covered in both the Post, the Globe, the St. Louis Argus, and the St. Louis American. 1960, they take the Venable home. John Birney, who had led the Citizens Committee, he had been the mayor from 52 to 56, voted out of office from 56 to 60, comes back in 60. So he's there when they take the Venables home. The park is then named in honor of Mayor Birney. And then they take the Venables home. It had been built, and they turn it into the park clubhouse. If you can just imagine, it was a beautiful suburban ranch house that is the clubhouse of a park, and it remained the park clubhouse until the mid-1990s when it was finally demolished. So what's happening today is that it's through a combination of a lot of people getting involved. There's an increased public attention to what happened so long ago. You know, I think for a long time, a lot of people felt, you know, this happened 60 years ago. How is it relevant to today? And finally, people started, you know, I think Creve Coeur, the leadership, the elected leaders of Creve Coeur decided that this is something that had to be faced up to. The immediate event which really got things going was Harvard University, of all places, has a program called the Commonwealth Project, which you can Google it. It was established to help St. Louis after Ferguson. And there is a history professor at Harvard named Walter Johnson, who is writing, is about to publish a book on race relations in St. Louis. And he sent two interns to St. Louis last summer. And they worked with me and other interested groups, and they set up the Facebook group, they met with the elected representatives, and at the end of the summer, they had helped set up this Venable Park Coalition, which is a number of organizations, including the Washington University School of Medicine staff physicians, different religious organizations, including Sheremeth Congregation, and this has really moved the thing along. Another big thing was that Tony Messenger, you know, Pulitzer Prize winning columnist at the Post-Dispatch, picked up on it, wrote two articles, which really brought the issue to the public's attention.
What do you think about what happened?
It's a tragedy. And there's no dispute about it. That was, you know, all the, it's so documented in the records of the city of Creve Coeur when you go back and look at the old newspaper articles. And then the more you look into the character and the achievements of Dr. Venable, the tragedy certainly is first and foremost what was suffered by the Venables and those other African-American families and what they lost. You know, they had the same right to the American dream as everybody else. But, you know, the other tragedy is what might have been in Creve Coeur if Dr. Venable and those other African-American families had been welcomed there in the late 50s. You know, what could Creve Coeur, what could St. Louis County have been like? You know, we'll never know.
Dr. Venable's family members have made several recommendations as to how to move forward to right the wrong that happened. And the former mayor's family members say they are not opposed to the idea. Another meeting is scheduled to take place in Creve Coeur next week. Well, straight ahead on the Pulse of St. Louis, a pastry chef in the Gateway City is making quite a name for herself, creating incredible treats. We'll show you after the break.
To hear more, listen to the podcast. Just search for the Pulse of St. Louis.
Welcome back to the Pulse of St. Louis. You know, a pastry chef who creates French treats that are simply out of this world is making quite a name for herself, not just in the Gateway City area, but across the country. Chef Simone Faure has a distinctive style and elegance about her work that will leave you awestruck. She joins us now to tell us about the secrets of her success and so much more. Simone, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you. I don't know about giving out secrets,
though. Oh, right? Come on, you gotta give them a little bit, just a little bit. But tell us, how did you get started baking?
It was, of all of the things that I tried, this was what I was best at. Because, you know, you do different things and you experiment, and I was in school for education, and then I thought, you know, I could be a sign language interpreter, but I like to talk too much. And then I went into school for nursing, and I baked in my spare time, and I had a much better time in the kitchen than I did a bedside manner. So here I am.
Here you are, and you have an incredible shop. Tell us about your bakery.
Sure. So Chouquette, or La Patisserie Chouquette, is a French New Orleans themed bakery that loves nerd pop culture and surprising people and making things that you're not about to get in the kitchen and make yourself.
Yeah. And tell us, where is it located?
We are on the corner of Tower Grove and McCree at 1626 Tower Grove Avenue, only two blocks north of the Botanical Gardens.
And when did you open?
February will be 7 years, lucky number 7.
Wow,
yes.
Congratulations. We have the address on the screen, 1626 Tower Grove Avenue, and these are your hours, Tuesday through Friday, 9 in the morning until 2, and then Saturday, 9 in the morning until 5, correct?
Yes, correct.
And then we have the phone number as well, 314-932-7935. One of the things that's amazing to me is that you make treats that look like articles.
Yes.
And food. Mm-hmm. Other than bakery cupcakes and pastries, and it's amazing.
Well, sometimes it's good to kind of open your mind, and you think you're getting one thing, but you're getting something else, much like in life.
And those tools, those are treats?
They're pretzels, chocolate-covered pretzels.
In this watch?
That was a birthday cake for a dear friend.
Oh my gosh, and the scary monster?
Oh, she's lovely. She's misunderstood. Of course, she recognizes the Billiken.
Yeah. So how do you come up with these ideas? And then I guess a better question is, how do you make that happen?
So the making it happen is the easy part.
Is it?
Well, because if you've had the mind to think of it, then surely, or hopefully, something has triggered, you know, a technique in your mind, or you'll see someone spackle a wall, and you can translate that into food.
Yeah, like a steak and baked potato, but that's really a cake.
When you're around pastry all day, you're just thinking about meat. Anyone who says anything different, they're not being honest with you. You'll notice a theme with my cakes. It's very savory.
Oh my God, pizza?
Pizza cookies, yes.
But what I'm saying is, how do you do? Do you have a mold, or how does that work?
You start carving. You start with a much larger cake, and then you start to whittle it down until it becomes similar to what you want it to be, and then the rest is paint. and illusion and, you know, putting other things around it, like the heart, you know, like take a piece of my heart. Why not?
Oh, it's so beautiful. When you were growing up, and you grew up in New Orleans, correct?
Yes.
Did you ever imagine that you would be where you are today?
No, I imagined that I would be married to Prince William and Kate's kids would be
right.
mine. That was, I really
was
did not
dream.
Have a plan B.
Yeah, yeah.
But it was definitely not this. Mm-hmm. It was, you know, traveling the world, William and I, and learning languages and being immersed in history. That I've always been interested in. But food, I think I took it for granted because I was in New Orleans and everybody can cook. Mm-hmm. You know, even when I was told my mother I was going to culinary school, Stella was not impressed because for her, she's like, well, what are they going to teach you in school that you don't already know? Because
yeah.
you're from New Orleans. Like, why would you want someone to teach you? So it definitely was not this.
Yeah. But you did work in the hotel industry as a pastry chef.
I did.
Yeah, tell me about that.
So I actually started out because I focused on kosher cooking and baking in school. And that's eventually what brought me to St. Louis. But I started off with the Ritz-Carlton as my first big job. You know, I was the cookie scooper extraordinaire. And worked my way up through the ranks in various Ritz-Carltons and Marriott properties. And when I finally found myself at the helm of the original hotel that I started out at, it was, you know, it was surreal. Because I was now at the top of my pastry food chain and looking down and seeing myself in younger people. And, you know, then I could do whatever I wanted.
Yeah.
It wasn't just bread pudding and chocolate cake.
Yeah. And speaking of younger people and young people and those who aspire to be pastry chefs, mm-hmm. what advice would you offer them?
Don't do it. Sleep instead.
Because you get up pretty early in the morning to create these masterpieces.
We do. These yeah. things don't make themselves. And, you know, right. my husband's a chef, and I always say to him, you know, you clean some fish and you throw some butter in a pan and you wait for somebody to order it. But with us, you know, things start days in advance, if not weeks in advance. You got to be able to keep up with it. And so anyone who is thinking about doing it, I think if you are saying you want to do it because people tell you that you make nice things, that's not the reason to do it. Because it's a very fascinating career, but it's a very thankless career. You have to do it for reasons other than I make nice things, or it's my passion, because I will tell you, my passions change on a daily basis. And if I followed all of them, we would not be sitting here, surely.
So why do you do what you do?
Because I am obsessed with creating something. And also, there is a little bit of an element of being involved in people's lives to a certain extent. Children are the best. They're your worst critics, but
because they're so honest.
That, yes, but to see that wonder in their eyes when they're trying to figure it out and they're so excited and they're so happy with anything that you do. And I don't mind that we have to clean little fingerprints off the glass every day because they come in and they're just like, you will never get that feeling again or look at something that way again. And yeah. we make that happen. And mm-hmm. that's exciting. It's yeah. a rush.
And you have competed in some competitions, right? Some baking
I
competitions?
Have.
Tell me about
Always
that.
A bridesmaid, never a win.
Hey, you're a winner in my book.
Well, thank you.
Oh, I don't count.
So I've done a Food Network Spring Baking Championship, which was amazing. And that actually led to my doing Cake Wars with my friend Juliana that I competed against on that show. And she called me and said, girl, how about we team up? And we're on the same team. And I'm like, okay. And that was amazing. And so it's led to all sorts of great opportunities.
Well, I have to tell you that it has been difficult doing this interview with this aroma of these sweet treats that
oh,
you brought
has
to
it
this.
Been?
Yes, it has been. So tell me, what have you brought for us
so
today?
These are some of our Thanksgiving, Christmas, Hanukkah goodies that we're offering, you know, for this holiday season. We've got our bourbon pecan pie, not pecan, pecan.
Pecan, I hear
oh,
you.
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. We have Stella's 7-Up cake, my mother for every single holiday. And I'm only calling it that to appease her, because she did not, I would like to go on the record, she did not teach me to make this.
Oh, okay. Okay, Mom. You got that, Mom?
But she always had 7-Up cake. People would beg for her to make her 7-Up cake. And really? It is a staple in the South, especially in New Orleans.
But you have to admit, you probably were inspired by her to make the cake.
I was. Mm-hmm. This is
so
not
she gets that credit,
Stella's
but
recipe.
It's not Stella's recipe. All right, Stella.
We also have our turducken croissant, turkey, duck, chicken, cornbread dressing, cranberry sauce, all stuffed inside of a croissant, along with...
You mean that's what's stuffed in?
That's what's here. And then on top, we've topped it off with fried onions, like the ones that you would typically put on your casserole. And if you were having this in the shop, it gets heated up with a side of brown Creole gravy.
Oh my gosh.
This is only served on Saturdays, and there's a maximum of 2 per person to purchase these, and that way we avoid all sorts of tears.
Yeah, I bet, I bet, I
and
bet.
And then we've got some pumpkin pasties here, which are definitely staff favorites. It's our pumpkin pie filling inside of a buttery, flaky dough. It's just absolutely delicious.
So tell me about your clientele, because I'm sure it's not just people in the neighborhood.
Right. So it's everywhere. Mm-hmm. People come from everywhere, and we want to make sure that we have things that are somewhat recognizable, but also things that they've never seen before. And so we get, for instance, our month of magic in October, we get those reservations in, and it's people coming from neighboring states. And so that's wonderful, because they're in town for a day and they came in to see us, and that's wonderful. And then we ship our Macaron of the Month Club subscriptions. And so those are customers, you know, all over the country.
Wow. Now, are your treats also in hotels and restaurants?
Some of them are.
Nice.
Yes. So you have probably tried our things in a variety of places. You'll definitely know if you've had one of our mackerel, because I could be biased, but...
No, not you.
They're wonderful. And they've all got usually our signature gold splatter on them. Yeah. So that's a telltale sign that you're having one of ours.
Are you the kind of chef that tastes as you go along, or you wait until after?
I don't taste as I go along.
Really?
And a lot of times I can smell if something is off, if a recipe from the oven, even before you see it sometimes.
Really?
Yes, especially if it's something like a cake.
Right.
You know if someone mismeasured baking powder before I even open the door of the oven.
Now that's a skill.
Well, unfortunately, it has been, had to be called on far too many times.
Wow, that's incredible.
And so it's a part of the, you know, the ongoing training, things that you develop over time.
Yeah, and you've got a big event coming up, right?
We do, we have our...
Don't tell.
Oh.
I gotta take a break. Hold that thought.
Alrighty.
All right, we'll tell you what's coming up and how you can get involved after the break. Stay with us, we are back in a moment. Welcome back. We are talking with pastry chef Simone Faure, and you have a big event coming up, right?
It happens
all the time.
So our Sugar Plum Fairy Tea takes place every Saturday in December, and we are now taking reservations for that. It is a wonderful event. It's a way to come in and make memories with the little ones, and it's all surrounding food and fun and laughter. And if you're a fan of the Nutcracker, then you'll definitely recognize some of the food items on the menu.
And then how do people make reservations? Is it online or do
they call It is through SimoneFaure.com.
Say it again?
SimoneFaure.com. Or you can call the shop and we'll assist with reservations.
Okay, and then because I want you to spell your last name, because I don't want to even think it's F-O-U-R.
Right, I know my father-in-law cringes every time he hears me pronounce my last name, but it's F-A-U-R-E.
Yes. Okay. All right. So I can't wait to get into these.
Oh my goodness. Yeah.
You know, this has been torturous for me.
Oh, it's so good.
Talking with you. Good. It smells so good. Simone Faure, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having me.
Yes. And thank you for joining us for the Pulse of St. Louis. Remember, if you missed any part of the show, download the Pulse of St. Louis podcast in the iTunes or Google Play stores. And remember, for news 24/7, download the free Fox 2 and News 11 apps. I will see you next time.